Hey everybody, welcome to another edition of American Rambler. I'm your host, Colin Woodward. Thank you for listening to the podcast. On today's show, I have actor and director Lou Antonio, known for playing Koko in the 1967 movie Cool Hand Luke. This might seem to be a bit of an odd episode. I don't talk to a lot of actors or people in the entertainment industry. I've had a few musicians on the show, a few actors, a few musicians and actors, actually. This might seem a little out of left field, but Cool Hand Luke is one of my favorite movies, and I can't remember when I first contacted Lou, but it was a while ago, and I've had this show in the can for some time, but I had a bit of a backlog, and it's taken me a while to edit everything because of just the general craziness of life right now. I was going from one job to another, going from one computer to another, and trying to edit all of these shows. And as you know, if you know this show at all, you know me, you know I do everything myself. So it becomes a real task if I have to edit five or six shows that I have saved up. So it took me a little while, but decided to make this a two-parter. But as I said, Cool Hand Luke, one of my favorite movies of all time. And I was thinking about it a while back because I was reading the book, which is pretty close to the movie in a lot of ways, but also has some major differences, some of which I don't like. I think actually the movie is better, but the book is quite good. But it is a different story that they're telling, and Luke is a different person in the book. Not as likable as he is in the movie, and if you read the book, you'll know why. But in any case, I was reading the book and thinking about the movie and the characters, and I said, I wonder if I could talk to someone who was in that movie. But it is a more than 50-year-old movie, and regretfully, a lot of the actors in it are no longer with us. Paul Newman, obviously, George Kennedy, Dennis Hopper died a couple of years ago, Harry Dean Stanton, we lost him a few years ago, he was quite old, and Strother Martin is long gone. And I found Lou's book online, titled, appropriately enough, Cool Hand Lou. And I thought, well, maybe I could talk to Lou Antonio. And so I got the book, read the book, enjoyed it. Cool Hand Lou, my 50 years in Hollywood and on Broadway. It moves along really quick, and it is quite funny, and gives you an inside look at how people do theater, how they do television and movies. Lou, he did a lot of acting and directing, but did more directing toward the latter part of his career, and taught acting for a while out there in California. So he has quite a resume, and I am glad I read the book, because I think he's a guy who wants you to be prepared in an interview. You know, I'm not used to interviewing actors, but I hope I did okay with him. We did talk for quite a while, and I thought it went pretty well, but you, of course, can be the judge, and you will be hearing part one of my talk with Lou coming up in a few minutes. What else has been going on? Well, summer is clinging on here in Richmond. It was not a hot, but a warm and humid day today. I'm just so over the bugs and the mosquitoes and the humidity. Really ready for fall to be here. I do love going swimming, though. We've had a pool all summer. I'm going to miss that, but I think I'm done with summer. And it's not technically fall yet. It's going to be here in a couple days, but I think I'm looking forward to that. Probably one of those days where you could have kept the AC on here in Richmond, but I wanted to open the windows. I sleep better when the windows are open. They were open last night, and I slept pretty well. Not a chilly night at all tonight, but the windows are open, and I just kind of like hearing the crickets and the noise from outside, and hopefully you'll sleep again well tonight, because I think sometimes the AC just messes with your sleeping, especially over prolonged periods when it's really hot and it's cool inside and you're sleeping. I mean, it's better than the heat, but I still think kind of messes you up. And it's been tough for me to get on schedule with the kids starting school and getting up early every day, I'm slowly making the adjustment, but I'm not a morning person. And so that's always tough for me getting up early, but I've been a little more determined this time around because you can't sleep in when you have two kids and they're in school as much as I'd like to do that. But I also don't love waking up on a Saturday morning at 6:30 or something. So trying to go to bed earlier so that I will just stay on schedule. But it is tough for me to go to bed at 10:30 at night. I know a lot of people, they can't stay up nearly that late, but I'm a kind of 12 o'clock, 1 o'clock, 1:30 kind of guy by nature. So just getting beaten into it, the morning routine. Routine is a sign of good things, I think, at this point with COVID and everything else that's been going on. I am trying to get into more of a routine, even if I have to sacrifice my quote-unquote nightlife. Other than that, watching the baseball, hoping the Red Sox will make it into the playoffs, but it's pretty tight at this point in the season. There are a lot of teams vying for that wild card, so every game matters, but the Red Sox are playing the Orioles this weekend and been beating up on them so far, but they got to win these easy ones against the Orioles, who have lost 100 games yet again. And I'm going to be seeing the Red Sox in Baltimore soon at Camden Yards, so looking forward to that. The only major league game I will have seen this year, and it's just about at the end of the season, almost one of their last five games, I think. So looking forward to walking around to Baltimore and seeing a game. All right, well, I hope you're doing okay, and you will enjoy this, my talk with Lou Antonio. This is part one. We're going to get up to Cool Hand Luke and give you a little bit of his experiences on the set there, and then we'll talk more about Cool Hand Luke in part two. All right, here it is, me and Lou. Well, thanks for talking with me today. I mean, I'm really excited about this. Obviously, I've seen Cool Hand Luke, as have a lot of people, and I was doing some research on you, and I saw that you had written a book, and I finished the book about a week ago. I really enjoyed it. It was very funny, first of all, but really moved along quick, and I really liked how you kind of took us through every point in your career and really went into detail about all the jobs you had, both as an actor and a director. But I want to maybe start just kind of like how you got started in acting. You were born in Oklahoma, you grew up there. Maybe if you could talk a little about, and we'll talk later about why you wanted to write the book, but maybe talk a little about, you know, how you got interested in acting and what were you doing out in Oklahoma?
Well, I was born in Oklahoma. Went to University of Right. Oklahoma. Played ball at the University of Oklahoma U. So I spent most of my life in Oklahoma growing up. And then when I reached, I guess, 22, something like that, I went right from graduating college to summer stock. I mean, I didn't even hang around to get my cap and gown and all that. I graduated. The next day I was on a train to Indianapolis, non-union, so that they took me. And I played all the old parts.
Now, I mean, obviously, you said you wanted to be a ball player, and I kind of did too when I was younger. But where did you, like, did you see someone on the screen or on the stage when you were younger and you said, you know, I want to do that? How did that idea get in your head exactly?
I did everything my brother Jim did, but I stole home. I had a coach. His brother was tied into the Boston Red Sox, so his brother's team played me and my team, and so he said he got interested and said, I told the Red Sox about you, and they just said, well, keep in touch, because of my coach's brother, Merle and Earl Appleby. And Earl was my coach. And so that got me interested in that. And then I was playing American Legion ball one summer, and I slid into home, and dislocated my right shoulder, and I was a catcher. So there went baseball. And and I wanted something to do. And Brother Jim was acting. So I did everything Brother Jim did. So I started acting.
Okay. So he's a little bit older than you, a few years?
Yeah, a few years, a couple of years.
3 years. Okay. And that's kind of funny. I mean, your family, you know, produced two actors or maybe more. I don't know. But you came from kind of a working class background, right? With your dad owning a diner?
Yeah, small diner. And we all went to work there. Mom included. I went to work there when I was 9 years old.
Yeah.
I can remember the first sale I made. Coffee in those days was a nickel a cup.
Yeah.
And a guy gave me a quarter. I rang up the whole quarter.
But it sounds like your dad was a pretty hardworking guy. Is that accurate?
6 days a week from 6 in the morning till he got home at night around 8.
Yeah. And your name sounds Italian, but you're actually Greek.
When Papa came to this country, he could speak three words, as you probably have read. Yes and thank you in English. And his name was Antonio, which had a U on the end. And, of course, the Irish guys at Ellis Island couldn't pronounce it. So they said, okay, you're Italian now. You're Antonio. And Papa said, yes, thank you. And that was that's how all that happened.
Yeah, so it's kind of a classic immigrant story, I guess, for your family in a lot of ways.
Yeah,
Oklahoma's kind of an
dad's uncle brought him over.
Okay, and Oklahoma's kind of an interesting place. It sort of straddles the line between the Midwest and the South. How did you like it growing up?
Very much.
Yeah,
did what we all did. We worked. We mowed grass. We lawns for 50 cents a lawn, and we played for the church team softball. And then YMCA baseball, and I was a catcher. So I did all of that, like most guys did in Oklahoma in those days.
Eventually, you end up in New York City. You know, you obviously, you started in the theater, and it seemed like you really liked it, and you took acting classes. I mean, you were very serious. Maybe talk a bit about kind of that journey. I mean, when you end up in New York, you start meeting some pretty big people. Maybe just talk about kind of like what was your ambition as a young guy when you get to New York? I mean, I know you wanted to be an actor, but was there a plan?
No plan. My cousin, Dick Andros, he was the only person I knew, as the book says. And he was a dancer and dance teacher. And he had a place where he lived and taught dancing above the Jericho Tavern in Greenwich Village. And so between his studio was a big black curtain, and he lived in the back. He had a little kitchen and a little shower. And he and his lover had a nice apartment back there. And I rented a cot for $1 a night, $7 a week, and that's where I slept.
It's kind of it seems like a classic actor's story in a lot of ways. I mean, you're sort of living hand to mouth for a while, worried about getting jobs, but you were very serious about learning the craft. And in New York, you meet Lee Strasberg. Can you talk a bit about him?
Well, first I wanted to verify that I never wanted to be a starving actor, so I always had a job. I slung hamburgers in Brooklyn Heights. I cooked on weekends for them. You know, I worked. I had jobs, and then I would go to Strasberg's class at 11 in the morning on Tuesday and Friday. And then I'd work in some nights till 4 in the morning.
Well, and it sounds like you didn't get off to a great start with him. It was something about Ted Williams and Willie Mays. Is that right?
He always interviewed people. He interviewed the actors before he would accept them in his front room on West End. And so I went up there, and he was sitting in the chair. And I went in, and he was a baseball fan. He loved Willie Mays, and I loved Ted Williams. And it was not an argument, but as I said in the book, he said, no one could catch a fly ball like Willie Mays. And I said, and Willie Mays would never hit 407 like Ted Williams. And he got up and left the room when I said that.
Yeah. Yeah, obviously you're two great ball players, but like you said, you were a big Red Sox guy growing up in Oklahoma. So Ted Williams was a great hitter. So I grew up in Massachusetts, so that they were my team growing up, the Red Sox, and I knew all the history and everything going back to Williams and even Babe Ruth.
Do you remember Bertie Tibbetts?
I don't. Who's that?
He was a catcher, Bertie Tibbetts. He was a catcher for the Red Sox, Bertie Tibbetts.
Okay.
He was the one that I wanted to be.
Oh, yeah. Yeah, well, catchers have it rough. I know you had an injury that sort of ended your career. That's a tough position. It's about the only position I never played.
Yeah, but that's, I don't know. I don't know, but I also, when I played football, I was a center. It seemed like I wanted to be in on every play in every sport. I was no good at basketball, Brother Jim was. But I had to be in on every play unconsciously. And that's why I was a catcher and so forth.
Yeah, well, that makes sense. And I'm guessing Oklahoma, you're sort of required by law to play football, right?
Absolutely. Well, it's what everybody did. I mean, the guys I'm speaking of. When you graduated junior high, you went to Central High. And you played out, you played baseball. And if you could play basketball, you did, which I was no good at. And I played baseball and football for them. And so I was a two-sport letterman. And Brother Jim was basketball and baseball. And he went on to play semi-pro baseball while he was in college. He went to OU, Oklahoma University, on a baseball scholarship. I went on a journalism scholarship.
Yeah. Well, you know, I mean, it's acting is a tough gig, but I think, you know, pro sports, obviously, that's a whole nother level of difficulty making it to the top there. Your shoulder injury got you out of the military, right?
Yeah. God must have said, look, I don't want you playing catcher anymore. I want you to be an actor. So you're gonna steal home, and when you try to get up, Coach Appleby has to come over, put his foot on your chest, and pull your right arm until it popped back into place. So that was the end of my baseball career.
Yeah, right.
I'm beginning to acting.
Yeah. Now, maybe talk a little bit about Lee Strasberg. I hope I'm pronouncing his name right, but I don't know a lot about the schools of acting necessarily. I know a little bit in interviews I've heard with actors and, you know, the method to, you know, Meisner and the Atlantic School and all these different schools of acting. Maybe just talk about Strasberg's, his philosophy on acting and what his philosophy taught you.
Well, he went back to the group theater where they all, Harold Klerman and so forth. I'm sure you know of them. And that's what Lee taught. A lot of sense memory and stuff like that were exercises. On Tuesdays, you could book yourself to have, you would book two people doing solo whatevers. And so on Tuesdays, you'd do a monologue or something like that. And on Fridays, you'd do a scene. You had to sign up for 30 students per class in Lee's class. And he was, I think I mentioned, I know you read the book, so I don't want to repeat myself. But,
no, that's okay.
When I went off to work one summer, these guys from Goodman College, big acting school in Chicago, they were using terms I really had never heard of in Oklahoma or in Strasburg. It was method. I didn't know what that was. And Chuck, which was Charles Heston. You know, it was a whole new world and a whole new language that I quickly adapted to because I responded to acting very, very quickly.
No, you know, I don't know a lot about Lee Strasberg's career necessarily, but he did do some acting in film and in other places, but after a certain point, he was known more as a teacher, correct? And didn't necessarily want to.
Yes.
Do film? I don't know. Yeah. Okay.
He started with the group theater, as did Klerman and other people know.
I think probably what
acted. Yeah. Go ahead.
No. Did he just like teaching more, or did he want to act more? Kind of what was that choice that he made?
He never talked about himself personally at all, so I have no idea.
Okay. I think what I know him best from, I think he was in Godfather 2. Is that right?
Yeah, because Al Pacino, who idolized Lee and vice versa, Pacino got him a part. He said, Lee, I want you to come in and do that part. And Lee loved it, and he was good in it.
You said something in your book I thought was interesting, and I'm paraphrasing a bit, but you said something along the lines of, like, if you discover things on the outside, it'll help you discover things on the inside. You want to talk a little bit about what you mean?
Let's see. Well, I think any artist, and I'm calling actors artists in some sort of pompous way, but detail and observation and absorbing the scene you're seeing, even though it's two people leaving a grocery store, having a discussion, you just never take your eyes off your surroundings or the people in the surroundings. And it's, number one, is rewarding. Everybody does it. It's just that some people then turn that into making a living with it. But many is the time in my Vaughn store in Burbank, I would, there would be a elderly woman checking out, and I would pay my bill quickly and then follow her into the parking lot and see what her behavior was and how she handled her groceries and how another one would handle groceries. Some purposely didn't take out carts. They preferred just to juggle their food in a peculiar way, and then some would take carts, you know. And then some would say, I need help with this. And the poor guy who was putting the cans in the sacks had to go out in the parking lot with her. And Oklahomans were poor tippers. Some poor guys, they're trying to make a dollar and can't even get a tip.
Well, did you consider yourself a method actor, quote unquote, or were you sort of taking from different philosophies or whatever?
I was studying with three acting teachers at the same time. Curt Conway, who was an old timer. He was one of the hottest in the 50s. He was one of the hottest live TV directors going. And then he got named on the red channels that he was a communist and he couldn't get work. So he started teaching to make a living. He was married to Kim Stanley at one time and people like that, if you know who she was. And then Lonnie Chapman, who was had run track at the University of Oklahoma with my cousin Plato Andros. Plato was a shot putter and Lonnie was a long distance runner. And that's
Plato.
I saw him once. Yeah, Plato and Demosthenes and Augustus were the three sons of the Andros family. Plato,
great.
And it turned
that's
out
great.
Plato and D. rather than Demosthenes. And Demosthenes went on to be athletic coach at Oregon State.
And, I mean, again, you know, I'm not an actor. I mean, I'm a historian. But we think of the method, maybe wrongly, I don't know, as sort of like a full immersion process with a part. But maybe that's an oversimplification. I know you were studying with different people, but did you not want to be tied down to one approach necessarily?
Well, I still believe it, and I believed it when I was with Lee, that each actor, each artist finds his or her own way to do things. It's like playing sports. One guy would at bat would dig in his right foot into the dirt. Another one would put his feet together. It was individual. In my mind, it was individual. And Lee sometimes said, particularly to someone like myself, that use it whenever you need it, talking about the method.
Okay. Well, it's really astounding, you know, all the people you met along your way. I mean, in the book you mentioned so many actors, either theater or film or television. You know, everybody from Liz Taylor to Burt Reynolds is in here. And it seems like you learned a little bit pretty much from everyone, even if it was a good experience or a bad experience. It seems like you were receptive at least to learn what to do and what not to do. Eventually you do make the leap from theater to television. Again, you're in a lot of plays and things in New York, but eventually you do start doing TV work. Maybe talk about that process a bit, how you kind of go from theater into television by the mid 60s.
In New York, you could be doing a lead in an off-Broadway play, which would run Saturday and Sunday, two shows on Saturday, hopefully two shows on Sunday, and you'd get $35 a week. So I would do what I would call my summer jump to guest shots in Hollywood, and make $2,500, $3,000, and to support my theater habit. And it worked out nicely because I liked Hollywood. I liked the weather, and the people out there were all kind of happy and smiley and concerned about the work. And then I would go back and be able to live in a $45 a month apartment room with a bath, with a toilet out in the hallway. But you can do all that kind of stuff in your 20s. You don't even notice it.
Looking back, did you like theater acting the best, or was it just a different type of acting for you?
Absolutely. Go no further. Go no further. The theater is it. Because your performance, eight performances a week, each performance is different because each audience is different. And many of the time, the audience would tell me just from their reaction what to do. And then also I could control the audience by the choices I would make. So it was exciting because I mean, I knew what I was going to do. But by the last performance, the eighth performance of the week, I was just in warm, fuzzy land. It was great.
So you really liked that immediacy of it, the live audience, kind of you're doing one take and you're going to sink or swim that night.
And it's a great partner. I always thought of the audience as my partner because they told you in a way, like some audiences would laugh at a certain line, some won't. There was a wonderful series between David Wayne and Tom something, who was a deadpan comedian. They were both on Broadway, and they kept notes, and it was published in Theater Arts some years ago, about on rainy nights, they got less laughs. Depending on the headline in the paper, did they get more laughs? And so much had to do with the audience reaction with what was happening in life.
No, that all makes sense, and I'm guessing maybe too, like if it's a daytime crowd versus a nighttime crowd, that might affect it?
Well, they had a thing back in those days called theater parties. Which is when the afternoon theater parties was usually women. They belonged to a garden club or whatever club they belonged to. And they would mainly be your matinee audience. And they were wonderful because they knew each other. And sometimes there would be a husband who had been to the luncheon and came in just a little bit drunk. And fall asleep. They didn't want to be there. But they're trying to make up with their wives, so they go to that stupid garden party. But the theater's exciting to me, and because I never knew what was going to happen, but I was prepared. For one time, I was doing Ballad of the Sad Cafe, playing the lead in Edward Albee adaptation of Carson McCullough's book novella, and I think this is in the book. It should be. I had a monologue once, which it was in one. That means I came downstage into the footlights almost and addressed the audience face to face, really talked to them. And one afternoon, and I always loved that because I'd get different responses. And anyway, it was never the same. But one afternoon, I was doing that number. And a couple of firemen came in, went over right into my eyesight on like row 5 or 7, picked up a guy who had a slight heart attack and carried him out of the theater. And I just kept on going. But that's what I loved about the theater.
Yeah, I hear stories, you know. Nowadays it's maybe more along the lines of somebody's cell phone rings in the middle of a monologue or whatever, and the actor on stage will respond. So those kinds of things happen, I guess, like in any live performance. And before we get to my talk with Lou, you can support this podcast. You can leave a 5-star review on iTunes, which helps people find the podcast. And I don't know how that works, but the more reviews, the better. At Amazon, you can buy my book there, Marching Masters, Slavery, Race, and the Confederate Army During the Civil War. And if you like the book, you can leave a 5-star review. That will certainly help out the morale of this podcast. I don't necessarily get a lot of money from any book sales, but you can leave a 5-star review of Marching Masters. You can subscribe to this podcast on Spotify, and you can send me a question or comment. You can send that through Twitter. I'm Colin E. Woodward at Twitter. I check Twitter fairly often, pretty much every day, at least a few times a day, so your messages will be read and appreciated. As always, thank you for listening and thank you for support. Now let's get back to the show. And you met a lot of major people, and I mean obviously the actors who went on to film and stuff, but also the directors. But you were not a fan of Otto Preminger. Do you want to talk about him?
Yeah, I'd rather not, because he's an asshole. But what I mean by that, didn't know anything about acting. Absolutely didn't know note one about acting. I remember, and he was sitting in the front row. He was okay film director, but then he got a lot of help. But he didn't know what to say. He said, "Say it the way you said it yesterday. You're not saying it the same way. Say it the same way." You know, and that's just stupid. That's stupid. I would try it one little time. I needed some energy for the character before I entered. And, you know, in a rehearsal, you just have tape. Like, here's the door. That piece of tape means a door. That means a wall. And so before I came in the door, I did like a little dance to give myself some energy because I was playing a hot young director. And I entered, and I did my scene, and the scene was over. And Preminger said, "Yeah, but you know, the audience won't see you. There'll be a door and a wall there. The audience won't see that little dance you do." I said, "Well, no, I'm doing it just to bring up my physical and mental energy there." He said, "Well, let's go on, but do it the same way every time." We didn't get along, and he fired me.
Yeah.
Fired me in Detroit.
Okay. Well, there's a picture of you in the book. Yeah, really. Well, there's a picture of you in the book. You're all sitting at a table, and just the body language between you and Preminger, you're sort of about as far away from each other as you could possibly be and still be at this table. So I thought
The first read around a table. Which is an old custom. The first day of rehearsal, everybody just sits around the table. The guys wear a tie and a jacket, and you read it. That's all. And that's right. What that picture was.
In terms of directors, were you picking up early on? I mean, I imagine you would, but early on, were you discovering what made for a good director and what made for a bad director, even early on? Maybe you can tell. I mean, people know who Otto Preminger is, but I know you didn't have a good experience with him. But maybe what did you like in good directors? What would a good director do for you in the theater?
Well, it's mainly we both knew what the play and the event was in the play. So that was no mystery. How we went about it, though, is each actor has his or her own method of getting there. Some would just jump right in, and myself, I would try different aspects of coming in a door. Sometimes I would come in as if I came in with a problem, and sometimes I'd come in as like, "I'm so glad to see this person again." And I would do all of those things and see little pieces maybe of each one on an entrance. So it's not, "Hi, let's play tennis." You know, it's just, it could be... I'd take an adjustment in one rehearsal. I hated being there, and I'd say, "Hi, let's play tennis." So, and I would examine what might be under and part of each moment. But only in rehearsals you can do that. And Preminger went flared up saying, "No, do it the way, say it the same way. Same way you did it yesterday, the same way." And so he didn't know anything about acting. Make good movies, but that's it.
Yeah, well, they're two very different creatures. I mean, as you discover later, especially when you start directing, you kind of realize there's a huge difference between doing television and doing theater or even film. But you're certainly developing your chops in the theater. By the time you start, you're getting these roles in the 60s. You've met a lot of people, and it seems like, you know, however much time you spent with a certain actor. The people you've heard of in this book, people like, well, Olivier or Liz Taylor, they seem to be real pros. Like, they don't mess around. We're really good at doing their job. I'm guessing as an actor, you appreciated that.
Yes, they both. You named two really professional, good talent, fine actors that loved what they were doing. Olivier, who was very gentlemanly. The first day of rehearsal, he would say, "Call me Larry," and he was playing a Power and the Glory, and he was playing a Mexican priest. And so every morning we'd come to the rehearsal hall in the Lower East Side, and he would be putting, get this, just for rehearsals, brown contact lenses in his eyes, which were blue, because he was playing a Mexican. So, you know, you hang around people like that for a while, and you really learn the disciplines and what's really needed and how to do it. But I was lucky to be able to be around people like that.
Well, and it sounds like, too, you had the good fortune, even people that could maybe be a little rough around the edges, like George C. Scott, it seemed like when it came to doing the work, he did the work. Even if at dinner he might get a little drunk or something, he was there on the set doing what he needed to do.
George was, I don't know if it's in the book, but we finished a rehearsal one time that I was directing of a television movie. And I had known George because I'd been on Broadway stage acting with his wife, Colleen Dewhurst. And so I've had supper with him and watched him say, "I don't drink anymore. I stopped drinking," which killing a bottle of wine was not his idea of drinking. So he would go through a bottle of wine at supper, but he wouldn't get drunk, but he wasn't drinking because it wasn't alcohol in his eyes.
Right, right.
But George was an ultimate consummate actor. He could do anything and would try anything. I was doing a comedy with him and Don Ameche, which is another story. And I said, "Have you ever read Peanuts, George?" And he said, "Oh, yeah." I said, "Well, you know how Schroeder would sometimes just go, 'Why?'" And he said, "Yeah." I said, "Maybe a little Schroeder there when he gets this piece of news." It was a comedy, and George went full out with it. Not only went, "Wham," but stomped his feet like a little kid. It's wonderful to work with actors like that.
Yeah, that's what I liked about this book. I mean, you know, some of these people, they come in for a few pages and then they go because you're working with so many different people. But it was nice to hear that they would be receptive, they would be flexible about a scene or a line or whatever. And I mean, you hear stories about prima donnas, but I mean, I don't know. Do you feel like you did not really meet that many prima donnas along the way?
I'm trying to use that term. I would have to go through old notes. I can't remember one, a prima donna.
Yeah.
I'm sure there must have been one, but nothing jumps to mind. No, I can't think of it. Oh, well, one time I was directing George Rappard in a television movie. Okay. No, he was doing a series called Banachek, 90-minute show. And George and I grew up together in New York. He was doing a play. I was doing his understudy and assistant stage manager. But Cheryl Crawford, who was the producer, said, "Would you be off left with the script in case somebody goes up?" Shelley Winters was in it, George, Pat Hingle, Arthur Storch, people like that. And I said, "Sure." Particularly that extra $5 a week, boy. And it was Shelley. I think I went ahead and tattled on her in the book. But I would have to, being assistant stage manager, I would have to make sure that all the props were on the set before Curt, and I'd make sure everything was there. And I made sure that in the bookcases there was one up left and one upright and one down right on a desk behind the picture. And I had to make sure that there was a shot of whiskey in each location. And so if Shelley went upstage to a bookcase, and if you were in the audience and you saw her head flip back, that means she just had a shot of booze.
Okay.
And she would do that three times a performance.
Now that we talk about this a little, it seemed like there were some people where you maybe, sometimes you'd have a bad first impression with maybe someone like William Shatner, but then that got better. I know. Maybe just tell the Shatner story. You met him on Star Trek, and that was not a great experience. Maybe just talk about that a little bit.
Star Trek. Oh, was that when we were in the desert? Was that Star Trek? Oh, no, you were talking about when
I think you had like a half.
I worked with him.
That's right. Yes, yes.
We did one. We did one and movie was, of the week, which was a big movie of the week. He was at in it. I played a ghost. There were three of us. The writer was flying over the desert and saw an old B-17 just lying there rotting in the in the sand. So he wrote a script about it. And I was, and two other actors played ghosts. And Shatner comes along as a real guy trying to figure out who was this? Is it on our records that it was a crash B-17? And that's where I first acted with Shatner. I think I did a small part on A Naked City that he had a lead in as a guest. But he was an unusual, wonderful man, just full of life. He loved being on a set.
Yeah, he's still going strong. I think he's 90 or so, or maybe older than that now.
I'll be darned.
you had an interesting film career in the 60s. I mean, you're doing a lot of traveling. You worked with Elia Kazan in Greece, right? You want to talk about him?
Yeah, well, I met Gadget. I mean, yeah, he didn't like being called Gadget after a while. When I met him, I jokingly went up to him at the Actor Studio and gave him a big clap on the shoulder, and I said, we have the same name. Because Elias is Lewis, Greek to English, and Elia would be Lou. He didn't get the joke at all. He didn't even give a smile. He didn't know me at all. Yeah. There was this kid coming up to him, slapping him on the shoulder and saying, we got the same name. So, but we got to know each other as time went on, and we worked together. I talked to him. He was a very knowledgeable, wonderful man. I learned a lot from him as a director.
And
just by watching, standing next to him.
You had a close call at one point when you were on the set, right? You almost fell off a cliff. You want it?
With Kazan, yeah. Yes. We set, my character, which is the crazy bad Greek, he falls off a cliff with a fight with a young hero. Falls off a cliff, and we shot at the edge of the cliff. There were two guys, or four guys. Anyway, they had like a plank boards there to catch me when I rolled off, and it would fall. You know, the camera was in a place where it looked off. I fell down the pit, and then they did a point of view of my body down there, and so it was marked by a particular weed. Go for the weed, because that's where the board is. That's where they'll catch you. And we did a couple of takes, but something always went wrong, but I never rolled off but once, and that went well. So now we're doing like take three, and I go to that spot, and I start to roll over, and I look down, and there ain't no board there to catch me. Same mark, same thing. Now, Gadge was full of jokes and jokes like that. I call them jokes because he was the only one laughing. But I just stopped right there. And he said, why'd you stop? Why'd you stop? He said, I'm the only one that ever says cut. Because I said, cut, that's it, man. I said, well, come here. And I said, this is where you had the weed, where I was supposed to go over the top and down into the rocky canyon. And he went over and he looked at it and he said, oh, well, somebody must have moved it. Well, no one trusted Kazan in that regard. He would do tricks like that all the time, and not just to get a performance or something new. Not all the time, but if he found a spot where he could, well, like in Carol Burnett, Carol Baker in Baby Doll, she has a scene in the with Eli Wallach in the attic, that a board floor, and he wasn't getting quite what he wanted. And I would always follow around. I wasn't in the scene, but I liked to see what he was going to do next because he was full of good direction and good tricks. And he had slightly had the guys saw one of the boards that she would step on. She couldn't see it, but that when she stepped on it, it would break. And he would get a look of fear from her, which is what she wasn't giving him what he wanted. So I was up there watching, didn't say a word. And she came to that spot, and sure enough, put her foot there, and it broke, and it went through, thank God it didn't cut her leg. But he got the expression that he wanted from her.
Yeah. Yeah, that's interesting. It's kind of like method directing, I guess, in a way.
Well, he found, number one, he would get to know the actors almost, just to know about them, which is what I learned from him. So I remember once at one point, he said, what was that your dad used to call your mom? Because my dad was Greek, born in Greece, and mom was born in Missouri. And sometimes Papa would call her, because she was beautiful, Papa would call her the white woman. And when's a white woman coming to work? Well, we all worked on our little cafe. And he loved that. I mean, he would make notes of stuff like that. He'd pull a notepad out of his pocket and scribble it down. He never lost a moment of something he might use later.
Well, and I know sometimes actors will, you know, whether director wants them to or not, they'll come up with a whole backstory for their character, you know, maybe a couple pages or whatever to get more into the role. Did you ever do anything like that? Like kind of create a narrative for your character that maybe people didn't know about?
The first thing that I directed, which was a 90-minute movie of the week for ABC, I cast just people that I knew from the actor studio because I knew they would bail me out and they were right for the parts. But I also wrote a half page or a page of their background, of their characters' backgrounds. And I must say, they really appreciated it. And I used to do, and they would probably do it on their own, but I used to do it when I would act about, you know, I mean, he's just not a guy coming in saying lines. How does he feel about this event? And what was the event before that? You know, do all those good actor stuff. And it was great fun. And some actors just did that naturally. And some of them would just give me a line reading with no life under it. And that's the actors you had to seduce into reality.
Well, that's interesting because, you know, there's some acting school. Well, like the Atlantic School of David Mamet, his approach is just say the line. I'm kind of oversimplifying, but his thing is just read the words, do the line, and then move on. What do you think of that approach?
Yeah, that's because he wrote the line.
Right, no, right.
That's he wrote them. He just wanted to hear them, you know.
Yeah.
And he would stress, you know. There'd be italics. One word would be in italics. Another word would be underlined for emphasis and that like that. I find that more inhibiting than freeing. And I'll get to it. It's like one time I was doing Cool Hand Luke, and after Luke gets killed, there's a bunch of us get together and talk about Luke, the prisoners, I mean. And at one point, before we start the scene, Stuart Rosenberg, the director, who had been an Irish literature teacher in college, and he hadn't directed much, knew nothing about actors. But right before the scene, he said, it was a key scene, and he said, oh, Lou, I want tears. And I exploded. No, God damn it. You know, these guys would never cry in front of each other because they'd be labeled as sissy and they'd be going to be. And I gave him like a string of why it would be wrong for my character to cry in front of other convicts. But then I just shut up. But a residue of that emotion was there. And I just lay there for a while, re-experiencing some of it, just thinking about it. And that's what he used when he used just the part where I was near tears and frustration. But he was smart enough to throw the other stuff out and just get in there where he needed it. But he was not, he was a shooter, but as I say, he was a teacher in college. He didn't know what we did. He wasn't aware of what actors had to do at all. And you run into people like that anyway. Yeah, walk over there and over your left shoulder, say the line, and then kind of turn on over your right shoulder and then walk another two paces. Okay, most actors can do that. Some can't. Some, and particularly with any reality. But I know when I hold my classes at the studio, I say, this is what, you know, you're going to be asked to do stuff like this. And of course, we can do anything we're asked. So And here's some of the ways to do it. You know, it's, each director sometimes, well, particularly a writer, when he's directing, though, I didn't run into that much, because he was smart. One young writer came to the set when I was directing something else, just to see what went on a soundstage. He had never been on a soundstage because he was up in his room writing, and he sat there, and he was a nice guy, and he was just enthralled by. Can you imagine a guy that had been writing for about 2 or 3 years as a successful screenwriter, television, had never been on a set to watch, and he said, "I'm coming back every day if I can." And I said, "Absolutely, sure." But it's true. A lot of the time, people doing what they're doing don't know what they're doing.
Yeah. Well, as you talk about with your directing career, it's a lot of on-the-job training. But before we get to that, I want to talk about about Cool Hand Luke, because I mean, obviously that's where you get the name of your book, Cool Hand Lou, from. And you were just talking about Rosenberg, how he didn't have much experience with actors, but I love that movie. It's a classic movie. You and everybody else in that movie is so great. The cast is just unreal. But it's a very tight movie. I mean, if Rosenberg didn't have a lot of experience, he knew what he was doing once he got in the helm, because I feel like that's a movie where there's not a real wasted second. When you were on set, like, how did it feel? Did it feel like you guys were making a real classic, or was it kind of just another job for you? What was your experience? Well, first of all, maybe just talk about how you got that role.
I think it's dangerous.
Yeah.
Let me think. Stu was directing an episode of a short-lived series in New York, and I was a guest star on it. And my first scene, I was in the box, witness box, and talking, and it had some stuff underneath. He just wasn't saying, "This is what happened." The character was going through some stuff. And he saw me do a rehearsal. I just sitting there in the witness box. And he came over and he said to me just very simply, "Go for the fences." And that's all he said. I knew what he meant. And I opened it up and bingo, it was all there. But he, by that simple sentence to me, he encouraged me to find the emotion of the character in that situation. And he did, but that's the way he would, he would say things, as I mentioned, "Oh yeah, I want tears." Well, God, now you have to dig in, and because it's not right, in my viewpoint, it wasn't right, but for the whole piece, I said, give me a minute, Stu, and I'm trying to see how this scene fit the whole play. Because for me to just go in there and start blubbering was wrong for my character. One convict would never let another convict seem be sensitive, or they'd be picked on and raped and everything else. And so he gave me a second, and I saw how he was right. But he didn't know anything about directing actors, but he knew what the result had to be. And I had to fill in the part that would bring that emotion to the scene. No help from him. He would just make a command. "Bring me tears. Give me tears." Well, and well, you read a script too, and in the dreaded parentheses under your character's name before a speech, the parentheses will say something like screaming or laughing, or he'll give you a direction for it. And sometimes when I was working with Lonnie taught me, Chapman, he said, when you get a script, get a black crayon and just mark out all of it says in the parentheses. Discover it yourself. And he was right, because you would discover it, and it would be organic, not trying to be what that thing mentioned. But Lonnie was knew about acting. He was a wonderful acting director.
All right, that was part one of my talk with Lou Antonio. I hope you enjoyed that. And check out his book, Cool Hand Lou. My 50 Years in Hollywood and on Broadway. It was published back in 2017, so not that long ago, but it is available on Amazon. You can also get it at Lou's website, but it is a fun book to read and really gives you a lot of great insights into acting and directing and all the Hollywood stuff, the Hollywood life. So if you are someone thinking about doing that for a living, and you're thinking of going out to Hollywood and giving it a shot, this is a book you might want to read and get a very realistic sense of what that life and career is and what is in store for you. And what is in store for the rest of you is part two that will be coming up on the next edition of American Rambler, to sound like a TV show from the 1960s. And in the meantime, you can read Lou's book, or you can read my book, Marching Masters, Slavery, Race, and the Confederate Army During the Civil War, available through University of Virginia Press. You can get it online. You can get it from me if you want to DM me on Twitter, Colin E. Woodward. That is my Twitter handle, and I'm on Twitter fairly often, so if you want to DM me about the book or anything else, I don't care. You can ask me a question. If you have a comment about the podcast that is, you know, not a hateful diatribe, I will put it on the air. So I'd be happy to do that and give some time to my loyal listeners, my small but loyal fan base. All right. Well, I hope you're doing okay and avoiding the COVID. Be safe out there. I will be talking to you soon. Take care. Bye.